Good morning to everyone and welcome to Information Governance Citizen to Public Administration session at GovInsiders Festival of Innovations. We're thrilled to bring you this panel in partnership with OpenText, who are sponsoring this session. My name is Amit Roy Chaudhary. I'm a journalist and your moderator for this session. In an era where data-driven governance is key to providing a better citizen-centric and customer experience, having an effective information and data governance workflow that provides for resiliency, frictionless service, and platform to scale is an imperative, as everyone here in the audience must understand. Our panelists will share what are the best practices on information governance and how they are best used by organizations and governments. Let me start off the proceedings by introducing our esteemed panelists. We have with us Xiao Xiong Chang, who is the CEO of SP Digital, Muhammad Hardy, who is Director and Chief Information Officer, National Heritage Board, Singapore, and Brian Chitteshwar, who is Head of Worldwide Industry Strategy for Public Sector, OpenText. I'll start off the proceedings by asking Brian my first question. Information or data is the most valuable asset that an organization has today. What are the things to look for in managing this information to ensure that it remains safe throughout this life cycle? I know it's a broad question, but maybe that's the best way to kick off this discussion.
Yeah, it's a really good question, though. I think it's an important one for us to frame everything up. So data hygiene is obviously really important. When we look at the data lifecycle, it starts with collection, it goes through analysis, and then storage and destroy processes. And there needs to be a rules assigned to each of these. And this is where some of the technology fails. It doesn't completely align with the entire lifecycle of data. And it doesn't fit to kind of the modularity needed for government bodies. And this is even more crucial now in the environment that we're in, because exactly what you just mentioned, Amit, it's really becoming data-centric. We're all looking to create more bespoke, personalized experiences. We're all looking to drive more value for all of our stakeholders. And really, it starts with the data that we have collected, will collect in the future.
Yeah, that's interesting. Anyone else wants to chip in on this first little set up our panel very nicely? Hardy, you want to add your views here?
Coming from a government agency standpoint, I would say that I already agree with Brian. Those are, I think, some of the tenets that are important, especially when looking at data management and also governance. But also, I think coming from, say, a government agency, we also look at some additional areas which are relevant, especially in the heritage sector, where data is actually quite important to us, especially the fact that we do have our heritage records as well as our national collections in Singapore, for example. But some of the things that we look at is really the security and also access control features and mechanisms that we are able to have in place so that you get a granular level of access as well as usage of the data. And also, and the other bit that we looked at, I think importantly, is also how we can have this integrity of the records safeguarded, not just with backups, but also be able to ensure that you have business continuity and disaster recovery. So these are some things I would just like to add to what Brian has mentioned, which we think will be quite useful. A last point also will be in terms of capabilities. I think one of the things that we are very, very focused at when we look at data, it's the ability to search and utilize them very quickly, being able to have them indexed or, for example, I'll call it in older terms, searchable with metadata, being able to have them tagged correctly so that we're able to find it expediently and different type of users are able to utilize that in their different work environments.
Okay, thanks, Hardy. Xiaoxiang, from a private sector company viewpoint or entity viewpoint, what would your views be on this? We heard Hardy from the government perspective, maybe not direct government, but from auxiliary government perspective. How about you?
Yeah, so SP Group is a main utility in Singapore. And actually, we hold a very regulated and licensed role within the Singapore context. So the data that we collect are actually on a national scale. So it is actually pretty important for us to safeguard this information and also to ensure that the data that we collect has a well-protected and is put to good use when it's needed. The reality is actually as a utility company, the main focus for us is really not on data in the past. You know, it's always on being able to supply reliable electricity and also gas for the country because electricity and power is the lifeblood of any country, right? But over time, data has become increasingly important. And that's why as we collect the data, the way that we store it has changed very differently. And the way that we utilize data is also changing in terms of how we process it, in terms of how we store it, and how we secure it as well.
Yeah, you know, I just want to follow on this with you. You know, we've read very horrific reports of public utilities being attacked around the globe. I'm not going to name any names, but you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
But, you know, in this context, I'm just wondering, because you see, for example, SP, your group, has a wonderful app through which all transactions can be done. And I, myself, as a user, have stopped paying bills by going to the Access machine or anywhere else to pay. I just use the app to pay, and it's wonderful. But, you know, that presupposes a very ease of access to the data. I mean, the data that I require to access in order to do my transactions. But so in a generic manner, ease of access is a function that has to be there. But at the same time, as you said, that there needs to be security layers. So usual idea is that security is great, but too much security can, you know, sort of get ease of access problems. So, I mean, how do you reconcile the two from a public utility perspective? I'm going to ask this question to all the other panelists, but from your perspective, it would be interesting to hear your views on this.
Yeah, this is a balancing game, right? Like in many things, you often need to balance the ease of access and the usability of the data as well as the service that we provide versus securing it. Both are essentially very critical, but I think as a public utility, we have a lot more, I would say, we have a lot more both experience in managing that security and the reliability and safety part of things as opposed to customer engagement. That's traditionally not something that, actually, not just in Singapore, I think in most parts of the world, utilities are really not that well known to say, you know, reach out to our customers and try to give them a very good experience. The word itself, you think about it, utility, meaning that it's every day. It is something that you assume that it will exist and will serve you, as opposed to something that we exert certain like influence or a project, a customer engagement kind of thing. But that's changed quite a bit, right? In terms of the app that you just mentioned, we do have to balance it very carefully. But if you think about it very carefully, the data that we serve up in there is primarily very much geared towards an individual. So it is actually not, it's actually multi-layered as most apps are. So we do have the front end that serves, of course, your app, but it's very much layered approach in securing our data and our services. So that part of it, we actually manage it. It's like a tip of an iceberg in terms of the security and in terms of the services that we provide. But at the end of the day, that what we are trying to do is still take whatever data that we have and enable the customers, enable our users. So that's really what we are trying to do. In terms of the services that we provide, very much utility-based as of today. But we also try to broaden it to many different things and provide services that's really very forward-looking. Things like, for example, we provide MyGreen credits, which is a form of renewable energy certificates that enables our customers to layer enable our customers to use green energy, right? Because these are energy that's or rather attributes that's been created from renewable energy, solar mostly. So things like that. We try to drive sustainable messages to our consumers, and we even go to residential HDB blocks to do a lot of different things and so on and so forth. So I think that's generally what I would say what we're trying to do.
Yeah, I want to put in a quick follow-on question to you on this. From an information governance perspective, because you are holding the citizen-centric data, how is it being affected by the fact that there are a lot of private players also in the electricity market, and you are having to share your data, simple things like meter readings, etc., and these things. Yep. So, again, this comes back to that point about ease of access. So
right. You
keep ease of access, but you secure the data. And that is where, as Brian will tell us later, information governance comes in real hard. So, just a quick one from you.
Yeah. So the quick one is that because we are licensed and regulated by the government, and our regulator is the Energy Markets Authority, there are certain rules and regulations in place that we follow strictly. And those rules and regulations have been well scrutinized in the past. So what we can share with the retailers, what we can expose to our customers, that has been well regulated. So that's been well thought through, in other words.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. I just want to, before I go to Brian, I want to jump in with Hardy once more. You did mention in your first reply that, the whole idea is to keep all the digital records of Singapore's heritage safe and, sort of to preserve the records as well as keep it safe. But at the same time, the whole idea of heritage, having a heritage, board looking after Singapore's wonderful heritage is to give ease of access to people who want to know more about it. So again, you have the same issue, ease of access while keeping the sanctity of the data. So, can you give a flavor of how you managed to do that? Because a lot of access will now be online, I would assume, from the online channels. It's not that people just go to the library and just open books. I mean, they do still, but, times are changing. So, especially with the newer generation, Z generation and all that.
Okay, maybe just to share, you're right. I think that's important. But I think our data is not so classified or it's not so protected and sensitive as maybe some other government information. But however, at the same time, what we do have measures in place. And I think internally, what we have done in NHB across the board, and this is very much as we start to digitalize and transform the Singapore heritage sectors, we put in place a very good data management policy. And that includes how we inventorize our data, having a policy to where we look at retention. So for example, what we want to keep and what we want to be able to demonstrate and show. Also in terms of how we classify the data. So whatever you see on the internet, whatever is released onto the public domain, we have a portal today called roots.sg. You can see that you can search on anything on heritage and culture there. Those are really mostly scrubbed and also available for public consumption. So the I would say the more sensitive stuff, things like your donor information and some of the evaluation information, those are not there. So before we actually put them out to the internet, information is actually segregated. And we do this by government very effectively. So within the government environment, we do a private club and also a commercial club. The data that we publish to the, especially to our public audience, schools, researchers, and so on, sits in the commercial club. And with that segregation, that's how we ensure that we have proper access controls in place. Now, one thing we don't do is we don't currently have mobile applications just like, for example, the SP Group does. The sole reason being we're trying to be quite friendly with users and also focus on the browser instead. But I think one important aspect is when we secure our IT systems is making sure that we have all the necessary controls in place. And we actually work with the industry today with folks like AWS, folks, some of the other cybersecurity folks, where we actually understand what those risks are. When we look at mitigation, there's proactive mitigation plans in place to ensure that whatever that goes to the public is not just as accurate, but also the type of information, it's also valid because a lot of people use this information in their studies, in their work, and also research.
Thanks. Okay, Brian, we've just heard two very interesting case studies of how the data governance is being done. But you work with companies all over the world as well as governments and all. So if you were to you know, what are the issues that you think are the biggest concerns, and how do you see them being tackled, both in the government as well as by private organizations?
Sure. So, I mean, if I could just kind of add on to what Hardy was just saying, I think it goes back to kind of what I mentioned earlier, where the policies and procedures around what you want to do with data is changing, especially as security features or security hacks happen. And the technology isn't keeping up oftentimes, where you're not able to really fit what the governments need or the organizations need. And the reason why that's so important is a lot of times these programs aren't focused on what the mission outcome is for the organization. It's really just focused on how they're going to lock down the data. And that gets at the heart of what you're talking about, Amit, around usability and access. So it's, you have to contextualize it. You have to have it available for the folks that need it to be available. And some data can necessitate more constraints versus others, like Hardy was mentioning, the stuff that's more publicly available, that doesn't need to be as locked down. Whereas the things that could be, depending on what your organization is, vital to national security, vital to your organizational operating procedures, that stuff can get locked down. So you can provide that contextual security, as well as the ability to add metadata so it's searchable, because you want that access as well. Another key piece of this is kind of weaving into the fabric of your content management technology, potentially identity access management, being able to get a very seamless, easy access to these disparate systems where you are pulling information in and out of, because that's ultimately what the experiences are. They need to be seamless and frictionless. And a lot of these things aren't necessarily factored in when they're building these, building the policies, and they're looking to deploy it around what that mission outcome is. So it really needs to start there and then work its way back. And that's some of the things that we're seeing where challenges are really kind of impeding the organization to be successful.
Yeah, you know, just to follow up with you, Brian, you know, the access layers, et cetera, which you're mm-hmm. talking about, all these are, of course, necessary. But, you know, and I'm sure if any organization were to be developing information governance framework app Inito today, at this time and age, they will be putting all that in. But the very nature of data, as well as the nature of governance systems, especially for governments, is that there's a lot of legacy, not only in terms of data storage, but also in terms of policies. So, you know, how do you change legacy? How do you change, legacy? Basically, how do you change old habits? Let's just put it very bluntly.
How do you change old habits? I mean, I don't know if we have enough time to talk about that. I mean, I think ultimately where government struggled, it's not really a technology issue as much as it is a personnel issue when we're talking about old habits, right? Mm-hmm. It's the understanding of kind of what you can do with that data, right? And that's, I think empirically, governments have really been custodians of data. They haven't been taking that data to really actionize it. And I think that's kind of where you can build on or build better habits. When you're really using that data, harnessing the power of it and pushing it forward on behalf of what your stakeholders are and what your mission is, I think when you start to see benefits from that, mindset around kind of what they want to do, and when you can start to layer process on top of that data and so on and so forth, and really where you're going to benefit the employees, because those are the type of folks you're trying to change habits around. This, it's when you can show the value back to them, right? It's when you can start to use that data to open up bandwidth for them to be more strategic. We like to say shifting them from a low value to a high value work. A lot of this data can help do that, because they can provide more strategic, more bespoke experiences. And you can automate some of the things that are not. And that's when you can really have that automation conversation, because data allows you to do that, or the information you can glean from that data allows you to do that.
Thanks. I want to ask Hardy, do you see a change in mindset? I mean, not from you personally, obviously you are into this game for a long time, but generally, with all the stakeholders in your organization, as well as side organizations which are involved with the Heritage Board, you see a change in mindset of the need to not only govern, understand the value of the data, but also to share the data so that the value can be sort of really felt instead of just having an intrinsic value?
Well, I think it's true because, so I'll actually maybe take that question in two parts. So internally itself, there is a very good value in terms of being able to use this data, especially in the area of knowledge management. One important thing will be in terms of how you can actually share it in a very robust and secure environment, being able to utilize this in, for example, in our case, will be our attractions, exhibitions, and so on. And also being able to mine this information so that we can look at data, further data sets and amalgamate them with what we actually find across the government. So this is useful, especially when we look at trending, we look at analytics. Coming from that standpoint, I think on the public side, it's also how we give them access to more of this data so that it can be, the demand is there. So on the supply side, I think demand drives supply. And as we start to open up, especially with COVID coming in place and so on, moving towards the virtual world actually and having going to hybrid and work environment has actually increased the demand for some of these data sets. Now, but what's important here will be what do you actually provide to the members of public or education institutions or even students or anybody who's interested in heritage? It's really the quality of information that you have, the type of information. So this is now going past having to look at just text or just graphics. They're looking now moving into the realm of videos, into the realm of augmented reality, virtual reality, and a lot of other new stuff. And in doing stuff like this, I think one most important point, which we see this, and we are also addressing it, it's how we can look at the total end-to-end media supply chain to be able to provide it securely in the right format and the right timing, as well as being able to have this made available easily to these groups of people. And I think to do so itself, one most important thing will have to take place is really having to change that mindset. So mindset both having to be done within the organization, because you need to allay a lot of people's fears that, hey, sharing more of this information, sanitized, of course, will actually benefit them. And also the members of public to know that, hey, this information that I get, it's going to be accurate, it's going to be timely. And also we have proper rights management in place. So because some of this information, when it's used, we also be able to limit the way how it's actually been disseminated or put into good use. So these are some points I would say that we've actually taken and had a very long look over the last 1 year as we start to move towards expanding our collections as well as some of the research stuff that we get onto the internet.
You know, you raised some very interesting points, especially new technologies to access data like virtual reality and all those things. You know, you have to ensure your data is able to keep up with the times. I mean, access protocols to the data can keep up with times. But I'll come back to that a bit later. But Xiaoxiang, how do you see the change in your various stakeholders within the government? Do you see a greater realization of how data governance needs to keep up with the times, so to speak? I mean, from your perspective as a private entity.
So I think the stakeholders, I mean, for utility perspective, security and reliability has always been the top considerations. But there's always a realization that the data that we collect and the data that we that's been produced, there are more uses to it. Like, for example, today, I mean, I'm talking about this in a very industrial context, right? This is less to do with users and consumers out in the public. This is really much more like internally, how do we consume the data? How do we actually take the data and make better use of it for other purposes? Like, for example, we collect data, we deploy sensors in our gas network, and we collect all of these data, and we use the data to create a digital twin of our gas network. And using that data, the data that comes in, when building this digital twin, we are able to better manage and be able to detect issues with the network and be able to correct it a lot faster and be a lot more effective in countering problems during our operations. So the users of the data here has nothing to do with like anyone in the public who have no particular interest in this kind of data. This is very operational. It's actually what we do to make ourselves more efficient. And generally, this is the bulk of the data that we collect. I think the data that we incidentally collect for our operations in terms of trying to enable our consumers, like the metering data, for example, and the consumption and the I would say the financial data, because, you know, how much people pay for their electricity and water over time. That is important. That is very useful for many different varieties of purposes. I mean, we do get from our regulators and stakeholders requests to get this data in order to say formulate national policies, right? Because the consumption of electricity and water drives the or rather provides insights on how well our economy is doing, for example. So this kind of data, I think, are useful for certain stakeholders, but also useful to a certain extent to certain segments of the market. However, we don't actually release this data to the market itself because we are regulated, and under our license, the data cannot be used frivolously. So that part of it actually is still very much a guarded piece of data. But whatever we can to improve our operations and also provide better convenience for the users, we use it as much as we can to drive that purpose forward.
Yeah, thanks. Let me come back to Brian. You know, Hardy mentioned a very interesting point, which I, using virtual reality to access the data and other technologies. So, is it possible to have a one-size-fits-all information governance system as more and more new types of ways to access the data are envisaged, not only within organizations, but in public to government or public to organization interfaces where access is a key to the data?
I mean, I think the short answer to your question is it's very difficult, right? I think there has to be some modularity to the way you take a look at data. And one of the things that Hardy said that I think is absolutely accurate is obviously the types of data and the types of content that's being stored right now is very different than it was 20 years ago, 30 years ago. So you were talking about legacy policy. That's one of the areas where that policy needs to accelerate to keep up. I think one of the areas where that's really important, and we touched on it earlier, is how do you attach metadata to make this content usable, especially when the amount of unstructured data is rising beyond kind of what's scalable at the moment. So that's when you layer in those technology we're talking about, like AI, to be able to take a look at what some of this content is and glean insights from it. And then the other side of it is, okay, you have this information, you made it searchable. How can you make it visualize, or how can you create data visualizations that actually allow you to use this data in a more meaningful way? Something that caught my eye today, I thought was really, really interesting, is Apple did their big release today for their hardware, software, et cetera. And one of the data visualizations they had was an augmented reality where they held an iPad up over top of a utility, and it showed you the data visualization in real time. And I thought that was incredible. And it shows you kind of where we're going, right? I mean, government tends to be laggards in certain areas. And I think even the most cutting edge companies right now probably aren't deploying augmented reality in that way, right? But it's where we're going to. And I think that's the key, is government needs to have their finger on the pulse of where we're going, because that type of content isn't going to change. They're still going to be managing that type of content, whether they like it or not. And the policies need to keep up to do that so they can manage it well and then also use it in a more proactive way.
Yeah, actually, that's a point. You made another interesting point about how the unstructured data is, just going exponentially up. I mean, Cisco does these very interesting reports annually with zettabytes. And, if you want to increase your vocabulary, you can go and look at those.
Yeah.
the fact is, we are collecting data in an uncontrollable speed and amount. And that data is garbage unless you can glean actionable insights from the data. Mm-hmm. And to do that, you can use AI, you can use machine learning, you can use all the GVs, but first you need to have a good information governance policy in place before you can even do all that. So, can you elaborate a bit more on both the challenges as well as the opportunities that you see after talking to your customers all over the world?
Yeah. So, I mean, first of all, you stole my line there, Amit, because I don't say data is garbage, but I say data is useless without it. It's the information from that data that's really meaningful.
I'm a journalist, so I can use the word
garbage. There you go. There you go. But I think to your point, we've talked about the rise in the amount of data that's being stored, and that's not slowing down. In fact, it's probably doubling, tripling in speed as we speak right now. It's incredible. And government organizations are some of the largest consumers and producers and disseminators of that data. So to me, information governance, because of this, has become, it's gone from a very reactive kind of non-sexy role within an organization into a very meaningful role, because without a really strong data hygiene program in place, how can you really rely on this data that you're going to be using to move your organization forward? So I think that's really the conversation, is where that information governance program and those records managers, where they really sit now within the organization from a more strategic posture. I mean, I think their role's never been more important. And I think it's only going to get even more important as we go forward.
Yeah, great. I want to bring in Hardy here, data hygiene. Now, that is a big, big, important phrase that is heard increasingly. And in terms of your context, your organization, what is your views about data hygiene?
So I think it's something that's very important to us, especially so given that the Singapore heritage sector has been playing catch up over the last few years, both on the tech side and also on the data management side. Now, why do I say that is because internally within the National Heritage Board, we do have a lot of files. We call them, we put them in a dusty old shoebox, I'll call them, but we want to translate them. And today what we're doing, and we're actually working with OpenText to move them into electronic records management, having in place a proper system. So we move into having electronic registries, asset management systems in place that allows us to both digitize the physical records as well as digital media, for example, like your videos, AR, VR, and so on. But I think most importantly, what's I think critical is being able to have a proper structure in place, like having record managers at different levels within the organization, having in place a proper representation, a proper filing capabilities, structures in which the data can be accessed, can be stored, can also be made searchable. Right metadata is actually captured in at the point of entry. And we do that in various ways. So, for example, having users start off, we start off with using your email, filing your critical emails like your approvals, moving towards your project files, for example, like those done for attractions. And now in the future, what we're going to do is also put in some of the videos and all the other digital content. So it is graduated steps you need to take. But I think coming from the heritage sector, it is really, I would say, a three-tier journey that we're looking at. It takes time, and it takes you need a very bold move to convince a lot of people that this is the right way to go. Because I think one of the things we see is user pushback has always been the negating success factor for most of these initiatives, especially so when you're looking at having a good data management policy in place and having to put a governance there so it works. And also at the same time, having it to be sustainable so that everybody does it on an ongoing basis.
That's great. You know, but I'm curious, when you are looking at the old dusty shoebox, as you said, from the files, you know, say you find a gem there, which everyone had forgotten about, and then you've decided and you want to push it right into the front so that everyone who needs access and who will enjoy the access to that piece of information gets it immediately. How do you quickly escalate that from the dusty shoebox right into the front of your showcase?
Well, I think if you're looking at information that refers to our, like, say, national collections or having research, it won't be in a dusty shoebox. So we most probably would be sitting in a very tidy sealed vault.
Yeah, okay.
So we have the information in place, that's there. But I think the challenge is not about pushing the information straight out. It's how do we sanitize the right information so that it can be utilized by the public. And then today we do have a really structured process in place where we look at collections management for national collections. So like what I think Brian mentioned, metadata in place, stripping off the necessary information, even downsizing formats to something that's tangible, something can be distributed over the internet, and then out you go. I think one of the things that you can try today, if you go to roots.sg, you can try and search any of our collections. You'll get those information, just as how you just mentioned. Once our, for example, national collections or any of this heritage work is ready in place and available to go, it's quite fast, actually.
That's great. You know, Xiaoxiang, let me come to you. Data hygiene in your sector. What are your views on that?
Yeah, so this is a probably a little well-known fact for the utilities, right? It's like one of those things that you never really think about. But actually, because we collect data from everyone in terms of the meter reading, actually the data is not clean at all. Right, so it's actually quite there's a lot of missing gaps. There are issues with the data and stuff like that. It requires a lot of processing. So if you just get the raw data, right, there's still a complete mess. So you really need to process it. In fact, there's an entire industry of services or rather software called meter data management systems. And this is actually it's not really a cottage industry, it's a multi-million dollar business to really just clean meter data, right? And the players in there are like big boys, like SAP and Oracle and stuff like that, multi-billion dollar businesses. So the data that's leaves your meter and it comes to us actually needs to be processed. And when there are anomalies within the data, it actually requires not cleaning up, it requires resolution, meaning that we actually might need to send the technicians down to the field to really inspect the issues with the meter itself, whether it's faulty, whether there's some other interferences and whatever it is. And also, of course, with the advent of smart meters, it is not just about meter readers actually going down to the meters and physically reading the meters. It's about the network that collects the data and brings it back as well. So a lot of these factors actually requires not just processing, it requires manual intervention in terms of getting things done. So obviously, with that is a classic example of how do we actually then make sure that the anomalies and issues there are properly addressed in different ways, right? So we actually use a combination of data science and machine learning to really improve our operations in terms of not only just bringing the data back cleanly, but also to resolve it. And we use a combination of rules as well as the machine learning models to be able to allow us to detect that the issues are really real issues or, you know, false positives. This enables us to deploy our technicians down to the field more effectively when we actually collect data. So this is just one example of things, but actually a whole slew of other things that we do. So data that we collect in the field, they are really like petroleum from the ground, you know, raw petroleum from the ground. It needs to go through layers and layers of processing before valuable data is extracted, and then we can make good use of that data. And of course, the classic one that everyone knows is like, it's used to build you in terms of your consumption of electricity. But we are not just billing the residentials, we also billing the consumers, the commercial organizations, the industrial organizations. But not only just electricity, we're also billing, like, say, for example, water, we're billing refuse, we're also billing gas. And I think gas here, we are not really talking about the gas meters at homes, but I'm also talking about, say, the gas-fired plants. Like 95% of our electricity comes from gas-fired plants. We also build the generators because the pipes that go into the generators are actually from us. So you can imagine the kind of the volume and also the kind of pricing that we do, which we don't, the money doesn't come to us. It actually goes back to the whoever shippers it is. But we are the ones who manage all the data that comes through this. So it's very critical that we have the correct measurement, we have the data that's clean, and then so on and so forth. So in short, the data that we collect is really operational, and it is non-trivial, right? Because it involves a great deal of money that's been transferred. And also it involves like the correct operations of the entire, I would say, energy industry in Singapore.
Yeah, okay, that's great. Thanks for sharing this very valuable insight. But, you know, now I'm going to ask all three panelists for their view, because one of the points which I made while in my opening remarks is you need to have a system that can scale very rapidly. As Xiaoxiang mentioned, it is scaling very rapidly. So how do you build an information governance system that can scale, say, from arbitrarily, I'm saying from 1 to 100 in a very rapid manner, to keep up with the exponential growth of data? Brian, you want to start that first?
Sure. So, I think it kind of ties back to what I mentioned before. Mm-hmm. I mean, a couple points I think we've all mentioned before, starting with you need to have your pulse on the type of data that you're going to be collecting. I think Xiaoxiang just mentioned something that we didn't even touch on throughout this whole thing. He mentioned smart data and really the introduction of IoT devices into the ecosystem of governments and organizations around the world is something that is, again, just absolutely accelerating the types of data, but it's really important data that can be actionized pretty quickly too, because he's able to get these insights and they can apply process instantaneously to some of this data if there's a predictive maintenance issue and so on and so forth. So a lot of this stuff are things to allow governments to become more proactive. So I think having your pulse on what the types of data are is really important. And I think the other thing too is, don't try to fit a square peg into a round hole. We talked about the technology being able to adapt to your policies. And I think those policies have to come first and it has to be mission oriented. And if you're able to get that mission orientation, then you can start to scale that up. But without that focus on what the outcomes are, any type of scale you have is really going to be useless.
Yeah. You know, what's your view here about building a system that can scale with the speed at which data is growing everywhere?
I think we took a bit different steps so far. One of the most important bits we looked at was we started off not on the tech side, but really on the business side, and identify what those data needs for the business. But I think to address that, given the fact we are a very new entrant into this area, we looked at how we can leverage on an ecosystem of products. So rather than having so many separate systems, buying it off the shelf or building bespoke systems, we started by understanding what our needs are and identifying an ecosystem where we can tap upon. So starting from, for example, internal registries for our data, that's for day-to-day use, right up to media management, to content management, and also searching and data analytics. And I think that's the right way to do, because it allows us to leverage on that investment that we made. Rather than building so many different systems on the cloud, it can be very expensive. What we are doing is just buying licenses and expanding it, say, CPU power as well as storage. And that actually allows us to reduce costs while at the same time maintaining scale.
Yeah, thanks. Xiaoxiang, you want to add anything on this point about scale? Yeah, because I think your industry is seeing what scale really is all about in the Singapore context.
Singapore is actually very small in terms of the scale of utility, right? I mean, we are talking about in Singapore 1.6 million residential accounts, that's household accounts, right? That's like really a fragment of whatever other bigger utilities do, like the big utilities in Europe and in US, for example. They have tens of millions and hundreds of millions of subscribers. So our scale is very small. But at the same time, at a national level, actually, we do collect a lot of data. And because our data is regulated, so we actually, they are all in our data centers. So we actually build our own data centers and we run our own systems and so on. But we do scale to the cloud whenever it's necessary, whenever certain data is not as confidential and so on. So we do have that, I would say, stretch from our data centers and our systems all the way to the cloud. So there is a kind of a distribution and I would say classification of data that at which level and so on and so forth. So that's something that we do.
Okay, that's great. Okay, Brian, I'd like to ask you, say if someone came to you and asked you that, look, we want to build a great data governance system for our organization. What do you need to do? I mean, essentially, can you walk us through what is required? I mean, let's say this particular organization has legacy data, legacy governance issues, and wants to transform that into something modern and, you know, best practices, etc.
Yeah, so I mean, I feel like a broken record here, but I want to know kind of what their organization is looking to do, right? And where have their challenges been, especially across collaboration with the data? Mm-hmm. I think we've seen a lot of our customers that are struggling with something that I'm sure some of the listeners are struggling with as well, is that those data silos. And how do you take just a storage, if you think about it, it's just a large storage container, how do you take that and really allow it to be a more collaborative environment? So I think those are the type of strategies we'd want to figure out, kind of where they've struggled in those kind of areas. And then work to build, like I said, build that policy around what they're looking to achieve. And then we can layer on the technology. And I think the other piece of that too, and I know you touched on it to me before, I think we all kind of spoke about it, is what does the adoption look like? I think that's another factor that needs to be addressed too. One of the things that we're doing at OpenText is we're really trying to ensure that our enterprise content management systems are interoperable with some of the more common interfaces that users are in every day. Great example is Microsoft Teams. Our ECM is directly integrated into a Microsoft Teams environment, so you can access your data in the same environment you're doing collaboration across your departments with. Everybody wants to use the same things they use. I know I do too. I don't want to have to go to five or six different windows to facilitate one thing when I can be in my single Teams instance and do that. So I think that's an important thing that that we're trying to bring to them, as well as that ease of use too, because ultimately what it gets to is the adoption rate. And if you can get people that using the technology that you've layered on top of it, then I think the data hygiene is going to be better. And they're going to want to be in there, right? They're going to want to be doing exactly what the policies are put in place to do. So I think all of those pieces are an important factors to take a look at and address.
Thanks. You brought a very important point, which we didn't discuss before. We've been talking about information governance as a silo, but it can never work as a silo. You have 10, 15 different systems pulling information from all over the place. And so how do you get a good information governance system to talk to each other in order to get everything done very smoothly? Xiaoxiang, can you give some perspective on this? Because your organization would have lots and lots of different systems and processes by which you're collecting information. How do you pull all that in and get an information governance system that is seamless across whichever device or whichever system that is used?
Yeah, it's difficult, I would say. It's actually not easy because, again, I wanted to stress that, utility business, it's traditional and conservative. That's one thing that I really want to. And the technology, the IT systems that are in place is really not top of mind most of the time, right? For the people in the industry, because we manage like the large transformers, substations, switchgear, cables, and the pipes and stuff like that. So these are industrial things that the business itself is very focused on managing. The other kind of systems that they would manage are the SCADA systems and the control systems that would manage and monitor all of these equipment. So that's the primary business. Data is a byproduct. And because of the security required and because of the regulatory compliance that's required, this is all often an afterthought, meaning that all of these systems are actually isolated and disparate. Bringing all of this information together, bringing it into one place, it's actually quite a mountain to climb to even like start the conversation. Actually, we have started something, not entirely. We don't have all the data in one place, but in a project that we launched a few years ago, it's actually a relatively big project. We built a business data lake. That's the term that we call internally. And we use this data lake to really start accumulating the data from the different sources. But the governance within that is actually very important, because We are governed by different regulations and actually laws. Like our two main businesses are governed by the transmission code, the electricity transmission code, as well as the metering code. And we have to follow very strictly to this because they are actually the statutory laws, right? So we do need to follow them very very strictly. And of course, we do that in consultation with our regulators, the Energy Market Authority. And doing that, we have started collecting them and putting it together. And then some of the capabilities I mentioned earlier actually are driven by this business data lake, and it has proven very useful. And with that, we are trying to roll out more with our other systems and try to build additional capability. But the going is not rocket speed. It is actually going at a good pace, but it is definitely not a fast pace, right? Yeah. It's not, say, within half a year, within a year. We're talking about a multi-year journey to bring the data together and also put a level of governance that everybody, all the stakeholders are comfortable with.
Yeah, and I think just to add to your point, I don't think there is an end goal in this kind of thing, because as you said, it's a multi-year journey, but once you get to that position, the game itself would have shifted to another area, because it's a continuous process.
It is a continuous process. And of course, technology itself changes all the time, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So previously, we talk about data warehouse, right? We talk about how do we bring all the data in data warehouse. Mm-hmm. And lo and behold, this thing called data lakes has crept up. And then, hey, we're looking at new technology. Then, hey, you know, we're talking about this kind of different things. So as technology improves, we always need to keep a lookout as what's the latest. But obviously, we invested like a lot of money into the data lake, then we need to actually extract value from this for many, many years to come. New technologies to come in, that we cannot really just jump ship immediately, and so on and so forth. So all of these are actually different pieces of puzzle that we need to juggle and try to piece together. And that actually, you know, basically gives us employment, right? So we are constantly employed to continue running these.
Yeah, I like that comment you just made, pieces of puzzle. I think information governance are pieces of puzzle which you need to constantly put in place in a proper way. But Hardy, coming to you quickly on this, you know, I would assume that your challenge was a bit different, because most of the records were hard records, in the sense that your challenge was more to digitalize these records rather than sort of, you know, pulling stuff from different sources and new devices, etc. So how do, from an information governance perspective, how has the journey been so far?
Well, I think the journey has been very challenging. We've started off in 2017. So I would say that it's been a long, long journey. But I think what's important here is over time, we actually learned, and also we learned from our mistakes. We also look at the changes in technologies that are out there. And one, I think, biggest piece is we never walk alone. So importantly, what we've done is to work with other government agencies like GovTech, for example, tapping onto some of their current Singapore tech stacks, lessons learned, tools that they have, and also best practices. So this actually reduces the amount of time, that learning curve that we have to go through, especially with the last 1 year. But also in that sense, when we look at digitalization technologies, where we digitize all the content, there's been a lot of changes and a lot of new tech recently introduced over the last 1 to 2 years. And what we've done is to look and identify what these are, embrace them, so that it allows that seamless transition from the hard copies to the digital copies much quicker. And at the same time, it also allows you to, I think most importantly, bring that metadata out so it's searchable. Users can use it, and they have a need to be able to utilize it in their day-to-day work. I think that's the last thing that we need to have in place to make it effective.
Okay. I think we're coming to the end of our session. I'll just go to Brian. Any quick 1 minute point of view you want to share before I just wrap up the session?
No, I think we've covered so much, and I really appreciate the conversation. I think the last thing I would leave people with is something I mentioned before. I think look at the outcomes first and build your policies backwards that way, because ultimately what you want to do is drive value for your organization. It's not about the technology. It's about the policy and the people it's impacting.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. We really had a wonderful discussion, and I think we covered a wide gamut of areas, and I hope the audience has found it very useful, the sharing session. was very interesting for me as well. And, you know, I mean, it's been an honor to be with you gentlemen on this panel. And I hope we meet again very soon. And for the audience, I'd like to say we have another very interesting panel discussion on citizen-centric innovation coming up at 10:15. So do stay tuned for that. And thank you all and see you all soon. Bye-bye.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Yeah.